I didn't know I had works to display. So there's a little bit of stuff down in the art show. They're going to run up with some other stuff that I sent but didn't get hung. I don't have written stuff to put up or any of that. So what we can do is I can tell you the movies that worked on there, which is kind of an exciting thing to imagine and bring. And then if we want to turn it into a more intimate thing, we can kind of talk about how you go about designing for film and television. How I mess up all the comic books that you guys love when I make them really big and tiny. You can throw things at me. I'm good at nothing. That kind of stuff. If that doesn't sound fun and appealing to you, I will not be offended with you. I'm really good at talking to myself a lot. So, yeah? Okay, excellent. More into it. Do you want me to sit up at the microphones, or can I just be loud enough that you can hear me?
Or we could hand you a microphone so you don't actually
have to. Then I can't flail around with my arms. What's the fun in that?
You can flail around with the microphone
in your arms. Or people can.
Yeah, well, hey, here comes. See, Tanya, the savior. She's got some stuff.
I've got what's not on the wall.
Excellent. We'll find out what that is.
I think it's Oz on the wall upstairs.
Okay.
And here is the box.
Brilliant. Is that worth displaying?
No. You tell me.
This is a FedEx package. When I start a show in Los Angeles and I go somewhere else, this is how we send most of the drawings that aren't digital.
Do you guys need anything else?
Good.
I think we're good for now.
Okay, the art show would like the art in the box back so they can put it all together at the end of the show.
Okay. Cool.
We don't have a uniform
around.
We don't know why I'm talking about.
We'll know later.
I can someone stuff hold back. The art.
Here's my.
There's a lovely person who's willing.
Hello, lovely person who's willing to. Well, you know, and when I said we're going to make this a slightly more intimate thing, I really meant we're going to make this a slightly more intimate thing.
Let's all get up out of our chairs and
walk around this crap as it lays on the floor because I have no way of sticking it to the walls.
Perfect.
And then we can ask questions and talk about techniques, and I'll tell you a little bit about what we do. How we do it. This is
trash.
This is what I also what you do with old drawings that don't matter. Using wrapping paper.
Oh, there you go.
So wrap the drawings that you're going to send to everyone else.
If they didn't display, I don't think they did. You need to show them the pillar.
The pillar.
I think it's the one right. It's the really damn long one.
It's more fun when it's part of the actual. So we'll make this a two-part thing. We'll talk about stuff here, and then I'll say, go down to the art show and look at some of the other stuff that's on the wall, and these will make more sense.
So this shows up, and I roll this out, and I'm like, really? You want me to hang this?
On the wall. So, okay, we can do this. If there is a way of getting some blue tape, because I know how fanatic everyone is about
blue tape. Oh, they'll get blue tape.
We'll stick some of these up.
How's that sound?
Great.
Blue tape shouldn't damage that either.
So here was the other unfair thing. Now, let me preface all of this. These kind folks called me a year convergence as a guest of honor. And I thought, why on earth would you want me as a guest of honor? Nobody knows me. Yeah, that's cool. So then a year goes by, and I forgot about it. And when they called me originally, I said, yes, but I never know what my schedule is a year in advance. I don't know what part of the country or the world I'm going to be in or what film I'm working on, blah, blah, blah. They called and reminded me that I was doing this in April, again in March, May, and each time it's like, crap, I'm in the middle of a big, hairy film. And when I'm working on a film, there is no time to eat, sleep, breathe, see my family, do any of that kind of stuff. I finished that film last Friday and started another project on Monday in Atlanta.
Wow.
Still here from Atlanta on Tuesday. All that kind of stuff. Pinewood. Now I did the last show. I've actually done three back-to-back in Atlanta right now. Pinewood, then one outside the airport, and now I'm doing a vampire diaries out in the air. So, yeah.
Nothing important. Nothing interesting to anyone.
We get to rest.
No, I'm very much in touch with my inner teenage girls. They're dreaming. Okay. Long story short, this was more of a kind of last minute. I have one of my assistants rapidly running stuff through a copy machine, and I failed to tell these were all copies of work. And so they've been treating them very gently, and like they have to return them as opposed to them being spendable. So when we take them to the wall, these things are expensive. It's all All right. How you doing? We're having a really impromptu and personal kind of thing as you walk in. I'm bringing everyone up to speed on my lack of preparedness.
Okay.
So we're going to make it a little more fun, and we'll talk about things. And we're working on getting blue tape so we can put stuff and talk about it. And you guys can feel free to get up here and wander around and look at things on the floor and until we get a chance to put them up. Everybody's on the floor. I'm serious when I say, let's make this interactive. Yes, and we'll talk about that too. So, for starters, this is my own curiosity question. How many of you are familiar with the phrase, the term set designer, illustrator, art director, supervising art director, production designer? Cool. Hands are up there. How many of us actually know what this thing is? A few hands go up. Okay, I'm going to work from the top of the art department down. On a production of any size, you have the production design. This is one of the four key creative elements in a television project film. Working with the director, the writer, all this to create the world of fiction that you've all seen. Sometimes on smaller projects that are very character-driven and happening in contemporary times where we're going and just shooting at local locations, I think, you know, the production designer is the one that's involved in selecting the local locations, changing paint colors if we need to, bringing in set dressing, all that kind of stuff. But determining and creating the fictitious world that this action is taking place. There's a lot of stuff involved with doing that. So the production designer then has an art director who is responsible for managing and getting all of that stuff done. So being the production designer, the awesome part is really you just blow your nose in a napkin and hand it off, and somebody makes that happen. The downside is you have to deal with a lot of studio politics and hanging out with people. Really don't like that. Okay. Below that, our art director, like I said, those are the managers. So larger films, you're going to have art departments that have upward, I've managed departments of 40 and 50 designers. It's really hard to manage artists because they're all those. You get to do all of the budgeting and the labor scheduling and interfacing with construction and greens and every other department that was putting all the stuff up in front of the camera and actually doing the work. And you're just spending most of your time getting the people to do the work that they're supposed to do when they're supposed to do it. And get all those damn artists to get their stuff. Continuing further down, then you have the set designers. The illustrators have a bitchin' job. They get to sit and do some really gorgeous drawings that have nothing to do with gravity or physics or reality or human anatomy or scale or any of that kind of stuff, but they look awesome. And people get really jazzed about it. And you put them up on the walls in the halls of a studio executive, and he wants to give you a lot of money to make a film. That's not true. He wants you to make a film for no money. That's really helpful. Set designers are ones that nobody really wants to talk about. And that's cool. Not the glorious or the sexy job, but we're the ones that actually figure out how shit's going to happen, how it's really going to get built, how a spaceship actually scales to a human, and or a giant green mutant or something like that. But we're doing the drawings that are actually getting built, or are actually going off to post-production defense houses that are then getting bastardized by the post-production and turned into something.
Yeah, but I just
I hold two cards. A build number, IA-800. I hold a set designer card. Damn near impossible to get. And I have a set designer since 1996. I have been as a art director and former vice president of the International Art Director Guild since 1997. Which is really too expensive. In my kind of art, I studied theater design and opera. And by the way, you don't always have to stand here and have stuff. You can look, feel free to get up, sit down, watch some stuff, go up on the walls, mingle, and look, and then feel free to start asking questions as I babble on about myself, making this up. You can spread things out and look at them and then wonder. And we'll get to the digital versus traditional and all of that in a moment. My personal art was I went from as anyone, I came out of theater design. I did opera and dance for many years, based mostly out of Kansas City. And then after a point, I decided that I needed a savings account. So I moved to Hollywood. That was good. And I went in the mid-90s where every studio was throwing money at everything because they thought there was a never-ending jackpot of DVD sales to be made, and work was plentiful. So that's when I started. And originally my ambition was to be a production designer. As I saw politically what that meant and entailed, I was not willing to sell my soul that far, although I am highly mercenary. And I thought, that doesn't appeal to me, but I would love to be a really good art director. I would love to manage huge shows. I had some excellent mentors. I ended up managing and running some very huge shows. And then I had a family. And then production started going everywhere across the planet but LA. And then I decided I would really like to stay with my family. Then I started to look around at the fact that as art director, supervising art director on big shows, I was making money not as good as the people I was managing. And I thought, this is awesome, because I still have one of those cards. So about 7 years ago, I went back to drawing exclusively. Now I don't have to budget, I don't have to argue about budgets, I don't have to schedule, I don't have to do that. But what I do get to do, with the experience I've had, I now have this very unique little niche, getting into the traditional hand direct, where frequently I am either hired to come in and design and layout shows for people that don't have as much experience as I do, which is great because I get all the fun parts of doing it, blocking out big action sequences, designing really expensive crap, and I don't have to question. I don't have to fight for people. I just make my deal, and I'm done. And I usually stay there loving it and hooting and eyeing, and then the first couple of shows, we start to load them in on the stages, and it's like, what is this? This is not what we're talking about. And I quickly realized what was happening was they were mesmerized by the technology. They were being lost in that. And they weren't seeing the real design. So I picked up the pen and the white models and went right back to doing it in a traditional way. Because then we were actually talking about the design of the show was actually going to look like, the environment that we were putting all these things in. And we stopped having these kinds of problems. And I remembered that. And when I went out to Hollywood, it was at a period where the studios kind of really dissolving their form of art department, their form of training. And they began in the 70s, in the late 60s, early 70s. The last bastions of it were dying off in the 80s and the 90s. I happened to be there at a time when the town was very busy, but there were still a lot of those studio guys that worked traditionally, but who really had years of really high level training. And because I was one of the few young guys in the art department drawing by hand, they would talk to me. And they would kind of train me the way that they had to. Meanwhile, some of my contemporaries who were sitting there on the computer, with headphones on, and you know, your stuff's locked on the screen, the guys weren't going over and talking at that point. So they weren't getting the same kind of help. I remember that too. Then there came a time in the kind of early 2000s where I was going through some of the first calls on the show to the phone would ring. Hey, do you work in AutoCAD or Rhino? Well, I don't think it's not AutoCAD or some other digital line. No, I didn't click. And I was at job. But 4 months later, they would call me because, hey, none of this stuff that these other guys have been doing can be built, and we need to fix it. Well, that's cool. I'm still getting work, but now it's 4 months later. So I picked up the mouse again and started to work digitally. By the way, for the film industry, it's slower. We can talk about that later. But then I start to get to work at the beginning. What's been happening over the last several years, 4 to 5 years, has been there's kind of been a pendulum swing where everybody works digitally. And now there are so few people that know how to draw by hand. And the fun part is this is what actually sells. Is you can draw something by hand because there's still a personal feel to it. And because it leaves enough stuff for you to make up in your imagination, with your eye, as you look at it, that people will get excited because they'll bring whatever little bit they want there to be in that design to it, and they'll approve it or sign off on it, which is much faster. So I've kind of gone back to the other end where even though I work digitally, most of the time I'm asked to do the initial passes and all the layouts by hand. And strangely enough, nowadays I do what used to be a lead set designer. I lay out everything and I hand it off to a bunch of other designers that I'm then overseeing as they are working to flesh out. And so sometimes those people need them, sometimes those people.
Do you keep like a sketchbook or thumbnails that you show them first before you get your key square out?
Yes, is the short answer. typically, the way that I would work it is, each show you're hired to do something different and unique. Where computers are awesome is if you're doing the same window 8 billion times and you're using that one off the shoulder. In this case, I'll come in and I'll read a script and I'll have a conversation with the designer and get the intent for the direction. And then I'll sit down and start to lay out a series of trace drawings. And some of those will be freehand sketches, some of those will be more technical drawings like this, but there it's not as much worried about necessarily the architecture, but particularly with the number of action films that I do. It's more figuring out the true spacing, human scale and blocking. And okay, the script reads that this guy runs down the block and the car blows up and the side of the building falls down. And how much space does that really take? And it's coming up with that kind of massing and scale first, and then beginning the round of conversations of, I'm pretty sure that that's more than you guys have budgeted, so let's talk about that first. And begin the series of conversations. And then it starts to, after that, get more into the architectural elements. And always, on every project, any designer's vision or appetite is this, and even on the biggest shows, budget is this, comparatively speaking. So you have to draw their appetite and then start everybody dancing and figuring out what is really going to get back down to just like that. And that's where a lot of the rework is, by the way, where computers are handy. So yes, at this point now, one of the arguments that I use for selling myself to production is, hey, I can do both of these things, whichever way you want me to work. And they see that as opposed to a metric. You're cool.
So with with when you're designing on computers, are more of the, you talked a little bit about the sets not being able to be built. Are you finding more that they don't really have to worry about it anymore because they are CGI sets? Or have you run into that more? Or?
So worried about it, no. Where's our cut line going to be? Where, in other words, where do we begin the green screen in the real physical scenery? How expansive is the action? And in that aspect, it's still me laying it out initially because we're solving real world problems and real world issues. And so I will, again, start with scale human figure or the giant green monster, which it's going to go through there. And you're scaling and working for that. And then you say, okay, here's the cut line and all the rest of this is going to be green screen. And you're laying out all that stuff too. Not to the level of detail that the movie scene. But you're saying for it to be passed out and bid by a visual effects company, this is what it might be. Or an illustrator is. So the visual effects company can come back and say, yeah, great, yeah, we can do that for $200,000. All of a sudden, well, we could have built it for $150,000 and the horse trading begins. It's all about horse trading. But it's us doing that initial study, that initial thing to understand. There are instances in shows, if you go down to the art show after this, here's your first assignment. The stuff that they selected and hung on the wall down there, they're a series of studies of wagons that I did for Oz, the Great Power. Now, we knew we were building one of those, and that it had to do a whole bunch of stuff, which you never saw in the film. No, but at one point, the director wanted the sides to flip open and things to come out like it was a modern RV. So, glad that that didn't happen. But because we knew that set piece was going to have a very long afterlife in the world of this effects with all of that kind of thing happening, I did the initial layouts by hand. Again, because you get the fastest, most direct response to that kind of design layout. And then we actually did the drawings digitally because we had the information that the construction can build a part of and a digital file that they pass off down the line to this next department so that they can pick apart them to ignore it concisely. So that's a lot of times where those two things meet. You are still thinking about it for the future. Does that actually translate to what you see in the phone? That is also why I have divorced myself completely from what I do as an artist. Otherwise, I would be very
involved. That's not what we meant to do.
Yes, ma'am.
Is there any particular film or show that you're particularly proud of that maybe was like a big pain to do, but you know, the fix that you did just made it spectacular and kind of just stands out in your mind as, you know, special to you?
Ooh. Yeah, there is one. And see, here's the unfortunate thing, is the things that are special to me are usually the ones that just were awful shows. Oh, and it's because of either what we overcame or visually did. And then conversely, the things that I thought, why in the hell are we making this while you did? And then they came out for a huge assessment, and I actually thought, oh, I don't want to do that. So it's always the show that I worked on, this was back in 2000, and it was simply because we got to design amazing amounts of scenery, and the story was so bad, and they went from like it being a TV movie to a three-part miniseries. So how did they fill that time? They did nothing but drag across the scene for hours. It was great. It was a miniseries called Stephen King's Rose Red.
Rose Red?
Yeah. It was a big haunted house. We built $8 million worth of scenery, which is unheard of for television. So much so that Mr. King really liked what we were doing and started throwing his own money. It's like, hey, awesome. But yeah, so we got to do a lot of really fun, very sculptural. And by the way, at this point for me, not drawing a spaceship, not drawing a movie lab is cool. I did Ant-Man, which is going to come out here in a bit. I laid out the lab. But I got to do the Victorian houses and all the real architecture, which to me at this point, really exciting to get to do that again. Ornate and scrolly, and mutant labs are usually concrete. And lighting. But that for me is just because we got to do so much fun stuff. We were working with really great construction people and ended up looking really great in spite of the final product. That was a lot of fun. To me, a lot of the things that are memorable or great is more because of the talented people I got to work with. Because I always say this, you know, I've got the easy job. It's really easy to sit and draw this kind of stuff. And fortunately, I'm good at drawing it in a way that can actually be built and people can understand it. But the guys that do the real work are the guys that build this stuff and make it look like what I drew or sometimes better. And that I can do that. I can go out with a saw and sometimes I can't remember. They always ask me to do this kind of thing.
Oh, it does. I was just curious about that sort of thing. You know, I figured it had to be something different than, you know, some blockbuster and, you know, or whatever.
Well, then there is the flip side. And again, when I say I'm mercenary and we'll kind of take on the role, we won't pay me. I'm honest about it. I did the first Transformers. Mm-hmm. And I will be honest, I read that. Right. You make it what? I don't like it. And I had exceptionally low expectations. It's great, Hayden. Hey, big robots and meteors crashing in. Who cares? And when the first one came out, I will admit, hey, that was a fun ride. I liked it. I haven't seen the others, by the way.
Keep it that way.
Okay,
good where you are.
I will thank you. Thank you very much. And then there are other projects that that I've done, not from the set design end, but from the end of it as an art director and manager, that are kind of double-edged. I am proud of them because we pulled them off when we shouldn't have been able to, and they were definitely painful, and we survived it. Yay, I'm professional enough that we could do that, but, you know, you wear kind of like this bad patch on with the dripping blood.
Which
one? The one really where I decided I'm not sure I want to argue anymore was the Gacho, where it was done during the writer's strike with a very difficult director, and a show that we should have had a year to design, we had 4 months, and midway through they changed everything. So really we did it 2 months, and then to get the film we wanted, the directors started shooting lots of green screen stuff, and not only that, and then change the entire look afterwards. Which, by the way, had no effect on the fact that it was a god awful script and a hideous story, and it would have sucked anyway. But that wasn't what we intended for. But because of the logistics, the way that that particular film broke down, and I've done very large things. Typically, your very large movie, you're doing 15 to 30 large sets. And that's the course of the 97 that you should do. And you've had a few months, about 6 or 8, to design that in the budget. G.I. Joe, the way that broke down, we had over 150 sets, including military vehicles and specialty things that we built. The way that broke down was, and we broke it into 5 week segments to get people to understand that the first 5 weeks we were doing 26 sets, the next 5 weeks we were doing 48 sets, the next 5 weeks, and this was simultaneous builds and dresses and being shot. The next 5 weeks we were up to 2 sets, and then we got down to 34, and then we were back to 24, and then we finally had 18, and that was on 2 continents. And, yeah, now so for that kind of thing, you go, yay, we did it.
And that salary, right?
Yeah, on that salary. We'll get a trip to Prague out of it, yay.
So there's that, that fun thing, and then there's also the other side. No, all right, you're scratching, are you, is that
oh,
scratching
no,
or
I, it was both.
Okay. well done.
So you mentioned very little is being actually shot in LA these days. And I know tax breaks are a huge part of it, but what other things attract studios to certain cities? Like you mentioned that you're going to Atlanta a lot lately. Is there any
tax breaks?
Is just the tax breaks? Nothing else that.
Okay. I'm dead serious. I've been asked to budget the Knights of Arabia in Baton Rouge. Hey guys, you know, like, we've got Ensenada right down south here, too. We've got New Mexico right over the Great Big Sand Dunes.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Tax breaks.
I'm serious. Somebody's going to fund them 30% to make their fund. They don't care. That really is the. And right now, just while we're on it, North Carolina has done away with their tax breaks, and every show that's pulled up out of North Carolina, they've now gone to Atlanta, Vancouver. Louisiana, which has been a hotbed for the last 12 years, has drastically reduced their tax breaks. Shows are pulling up out of there that we're supposed to be shooting at this year. They were looking for Mexico. Mexico's kind of topped out now. But Vancouver is entirely about chasing who's going to get more.
Tax breaks.
Yes.
What's the movie or show that turned out like exactly as you envisioned at the end?
Next question. None.
Okay.
None. And some of them much better, i.e. Transformers. Some of them much worse. I mean, things that had the potential of being really, really cute, really wonderful things. Got another bit. I did Steve Martin's Bowfinger. And that, the original script, and it was lambasted on Hollywood more than it actually did. And what actually came out was absolutely nothing like the script that we were shooting. And it was, the studio's metal along. And that happens even more so, and that was earlier in my career where I was doing $70-80 million films. And as the price tag of a film goes up, and the more of its money a studio is putting into something, the more they mess with it. And for the last 12, 15 years, most of what I've done has been very large films. So yeah, not a single one of those has turned out better.
Yeah.
I got to do this kind of stuff. You know, designed a carriage.
So if you had 1,000 of yourself working on a movie?
I would. Oh no, the egos. They would be asses every last one. No, that was 1,000 of me working on a film would be difficult. I would take a lot of nicer people than me that still know what I know. That would be good. But, yeah. No, and you know, the truth is, with Hollywood, there's phenomenal talent and people, but it's all about ambition and ego, and they're not being able to separate themselves from that. And consequently, they keep thinking, hey, the next thing I need to be with art director, manager, production design. The truth is, no, because you're a bad manager. And you're a great artist. That's not right. That's really all you should do. And it's when they keep going up the ladder that I get they're really difficult. And then you can ask them to work with them. And eventually you get it. But we're not talking much about the art. Yes?
Was there ever a project that you didn't get that you really wished you had been able to work on?
Yes and no. And by that, I mean there are some fabulous things out there that I really enjoy the subject matter. But my curse is I also know the other people that are working on it. And I'll use it as an example. One of the designers that I really love working with, it was going to be a problem for me, called me months ago, because he was on the short list to do the next Guardians of the Galaxy. Now, I love Guardians of the Galaxy. I love the underwriting and watching the paint covers. And I thought, God, yes, that would be so cool. And he called me and I was like, crap, I don't want to art direct anymore. That would be bad. But I'm really agonizing and I'm talking to my wife about it. Well, he didn't get the call. And I'm thinking, damn. I'll do it, done that. Maybe I will do that. And then I found out who was designing it. It's like, no, I don't want to do that. So it's, again, it's more about the people that are involved. But yeah, there are a lot of things out there. It's that trick of in the end, it looks like a really fun ride, but you know what it took to get there. So you come out of the theater going, God, I wish I had done that. And then you remember talking to your friends that actually did do that and going, God, that wasn't good enough. So the way that you're just most happy is you say, hey, I'm working. I'm lucky. And that's it. And for me, you know, on the artistic side, I am, people ask me when they found out I was coming. Was, hey, that's great, and why are you excited? And the truth is, I'm not a huge comic book fan. And I will stand out on the balcony, I'll watch everybody down around the pool and everything. And the fun thing for me is, you know, here's a large group of people, and this is a creative outlet, and I don't know what they do during the day. They're programmers or accountants or bank tellers or whatever, and this is what makes them happy and fulfilled, and it's their creative thing. And I am the luckiest person I've ever known in that world. I get to do that every day for work, and it doesn't have the same pressures as an architect or somebody does it for real. I get to draw things that nobody can build or afford to build enough to call it all of them. But you know, it only lasts for a few weeks or a few months, and then forever on celluloid or digital. But you know, it's my creative outlet, and when I get to go home at night, that's when I have to. I get to have a lot of fun. And then the other thing that has been fun for me too is I'm at a point I get to come and talk to people like you. And I get to teach others. I taught at the American Film Institute, set design, second when I'm in town. And so sharing. Don't. Well, then there's one back here. Go ahead and ask. Yes, ma'am.
What is your favorite?
Okay, yes, you. What do you want?
I would like to know.
Yes.
What's your favorite material to work with?
You mean as far as medium?
Yeah.
Oh. Well, the vast majority of what I use is a Tombow pencil. Tombow is an awesome graphic pencil made in Japan. Exceptionally expensive.
Or maybe I should say, like, build for, like, you know, do you prefer doing, like, you know, being able to do ridiculously big things out of, you know, foam, or do you prefer, you know,
crafting? Oh, you mean as far as what material would that we're actually doing?
Second? Yeah, like, do you ever just be like, and we'll make that out of, you know, something ridiculously hard to do?
Unobtainable, yes. Yeah, James Cameron thought he was being clever by putting in, no, dude, that's fine. So when we're designing and building and conceiving a set, you are always, yes, there are different materials. There's not necessarily a favorite one. There's more of what's appropriate for what we're wanting to do. And by that I mean, you know, it's Hollywood because it's all fake. I mean, yeah, everything is framed up blue on. And if you're going to make it look like concrete, well, you're going to put a skin coat of plaster on it, you're going to put some pock marks in it, and it's going to look like concrete. And if you have to blow a hole through it, you're going to do a section of that wall that may be pyrosil or something that's incredibly lightweight but looks like concrete when you blow a hole through it. And if you're going to have rebar and all that kind of stuff when you blow the hole through it, you're going to do that out of foam for everything else instead of actual steel. So that is a more of what's driving the material choices and the fabrication choices, as opposed to, am I a fine artist and my preferred medium is clay and cork? But yeah, I wanted to see if you were actually
supposed to. Cork?
So, I don't know where cork came from. I told you I was winging this from the beginning. Yes, ma'am.
Are you
I'm
still,
sorry, yes, you.
Yeah, really. I don't mind. are you still doing any theater or opera work? Or
no.
Are you, so you're exclusively filmed?
I have been exclusively filmed, not because I don't like theater or opera. In fact, I had a lot of fun doing it. Well, partially it's the money, mostly it's the time. I just don't have time. And I'm very fortunate say that. But the other thing too is, you know, usually when you're doing this kind of project, you've been in that circle, and I haven't been in that circle for a very, very long time. And so I'm not the person that people think of. About the closest thing that I get to do, and I haven't even been introduced for a while, is I will end up designing stage sets for a TV show. I will end up doing something like the Academy Awards, which is all about a giant stage set.
That's, you won an award for that.
Yes, I did. It was a long time ago. But thank you.
Yeah, it was like 98
or so. Okay, so anytime that, here's what I love, is you'll go to the panels like this and you'll have a production designer and they'll be going, oh, I did this. I'll be the first to tell you, okay, yeah, I won an award for that. Me and like eight other people that worked on it.
Right.
So, but thank you. And that also, luck of the draw, that they called me, and that happened to be the year that we did something really good, and everybody else was like, okay, and we won. And there's also, I'm a member of the TV Academy, and all that. I know what's involved in the world. They vote for my friends, because you can't watch everything. And I was like, yeah, dude, how? Oh, Rick, did that? They laugh, it's the truth.
Wow.
So, yeah, and so awards don't mean
anything. Yeah, we did.
But I was lucky enough. But so that's when I usually the closest I did for me, my more recent career choices have been made not by the size and scale of the project. It's really been made purely by my family and by the present that they had. The only reason I'm out, I've done back to back shows in Atlanta lately is my wife, her work is taking her to Atlanta along. Lets us keep our family together. Before that, I was making choices and passing up things like Planet of the Apes and all that, and I was sitting in LA doing So, yeah. I mean, it was awesome, and I love Ryan. So I got to do a lot of stage sets there, again and again, because we'd like shoot 18 and 20 music videos a week, because we wouldn't have to do stuff anymore. Yeah, no, it's good stuff.
Oh, for the songs, right?
Yes, for the songs. Whole different cash cow. We should have a whole symposium sometime about the money. It's fun. when you guys sit there and wonder, how could they make that decision on that show and what happened? It's all about money. Somebody trying to keep a hold of their money to fight for more money. It's really amazing that anything gets made. Mm-hmm. Is that an itch?
All right.
You don't have to ask.
No, you can itch.
That's cool.
I get it. Is 3D printing being used at all yet in Hollywood?
It is, to less extent. Again, there are some designers out there that, and I don't know how they do it, but they get these magical shows where they have like 18 months to design the world. And you know, in that case, yeah, you can bring in some fabulous, talented computer guys, and you can wait for them to do their output. Which, by the way, here's one of the things I like about your average hand drawing set designer. When you're budgeting, your average hand drawing set designer can produce $35,000 worth of scenery per week. And by that I mean you can draw as much as a team of carpenters on the stage. $35,000. That's what in a week. And what is that? That's a living room, a little dining room, a little kitchen set. Okay. Technology, computer designers, digital guys. When you're laying out their label, about $27,000. Is that because they're designers or anything? No. That's because there are some inherent slownesses in using a computer. Computers are awesome when you're revising. Oh, I need to move this over. Just do it. Of course, you can do it almost that fast by hand. But where computers are much slower is in, because what we're doing, every show is a prototype. We're hired to do something new that we need to have to see. You're starting from the wide view first and working into your details. You're laying out everything in a quarter inch. In a quarter inch drawing first. Which is allowing production to budget it, and you're determining scale and mass and all of the visual elements. And while everybody is then looking over the budget, how much they're going to shrink the set, you then have time in construction can start to build flats with holes in where windows or doors or things are going to go. They're all working, and you have time to kind of drill down. See, this is telling us we're almost done here. You have time to drill down and do the details and what that chair leg is actually going to look like. Computers want you to work in reverse. They don't really want you to mask, and it's kind of a rabbit hole. They want you to zoom in and start working on what's that doorknob look like? At a period where, who cares? Put it in a circle. Don't put it in a defensive order. But so that's where you lose a little bit of time. Also, when you have a large room on the bullpen full of people drawing by hand, as a manager, you can walk through and very quickly see everything that everybody's doing, where they are in their project, where you have to light a fire under somebody to get a moving faster, or see something that is being designed and done in some way that you know that's not what I want to do this way. When you're working with digital people, it's all locked into a screen. Even if it's a great big screen, usually it's zoomed in and they're drawing a damn doorknob. So you have to wait for them to give you a printout. And in this case, okay, I've got 5 digital designers and I've got 1 plotter. I need everybody's drawings. It's going to be this afternoon. Where everything gets plotted out. So there you've just lost more time. So that's where kind of the slower aspect of the digital design goes. Because they're slower than people. Yes.
Research, are you doing a lot of research for, like when you're talking about the haunted mansions?
Yes. So what typically happens as a production designer has a vision, and on the larger pictures you have frequently a research department that, and by that department I mean you've got 2 PAs over there whose whole job is to find every image on the earth, every book, everything that has to do with what we're designing. I use the carriage. The production designer will have pulled images and will have said, I like this aspect here, this aspect here. He will have had an illustrator working on merging those things together and putting them into a larger context of sitting in front of the mansion or something like that. And usually you'll come in and they will hand off what are the important elements to you, or to that. Then my way of working, getting my head wrapped around it, is I will look at both the visual reference I've been given, and I will start to do a lot of my own research. And that's just to help, you know, because, again, a production designer is thinking of something in a wider view. When I'm hired to design a specific element, I'm the one that has to, you know, make that Lord of the Rings ring that's now 60 feet wide and has the ruins looking really cool. But he didn't think about that. But somebody sat down and figured out whatever one of those things looked like. And then, how deep they were and all that. So when I'm the one being asked to bring a very high level of detail to something, that's when I start to do my own reference and research, because I will probably come across more images, more elements, more things that I'm going to incorporate into the final design than production design. And then it becomes, a lot of times, with people in interplay, and I go back and say, look at this stuff that I found. Isn't this really cool? Sometimes it'll redirect the whole thing. Sometimes it'll be incorporated. And sometimes it'll be completely mixed. And no, I have this over here. And that's when it's really hard, because somebody has a very different taste or aesthetic than you. You really don't know. Oh, it's painful. So I'll turn around and on a sketch, quickly do what I wanted, and then I'll put it aside so I got it. That's the thing that I show in an interview. This is what, and they'll say, why wasn't that in the film? I say, I don't know. This is what I can do. So. Yes, sir.
I wanted to ask, you mentioned that you like with animals, right? It's more like interesting materials or like detail work. Do you have a preference of working with something that's like a made up location, or do you like designing to like a shot in LA or like a Milwaukee or something like that? The real place.
Designing from the ground up is more fun, but there's a caveat. That is where you have to be very disciplined and ready and able to quickly commit to something. And what I mean by that is, if you're dealing with a physical location, you have certain set parameters that you have to deal with. The room is this big. There are pilasters here that I'm going to have to do something with if I want to make this look like a giant film lab. I have to deal with those things in the background. When you have people that it's hard to get them to make decisions, that kind of thing, dude, you have to do this. These are here. We're not taking them out. That helps smooth things along. Because, okay, we have to. When you're dealing with somebody that's not metal and you've got an open blank stage and you're just going from concrete up, it becomes more difficult because they want to sit and mess with and fiddle with everything forever for a night. My way of dealing with that is I will draw as fast as I can and get so deep into a set that it starts to they start to think that a lot of it's real and they can't change it too much or mess with it too much because that would be holding me down. But I enjoy having a blank stage and getting to go from there, and or a giant blank field, creating a giant polygon city from nothing. That to me is awesome. Yes. And that's how I use a lot of theater. A lot of tricks to save production. I did the whole war room sequence for the X-Men 3 film, which, you know, we're shooting it all at night. So I could put up telephone poles and all sorts of gag and backlight. And you think there's a whole lot of stuff back there.
Oh, I put up a window frame.
Looks cool for the light. So those kind of things. Yes, sir.
Outside of the experience you get from actually working in the film, what did you do to essentially get better at what you wanted to do?
I missed the first half of the question. I got to get better to do.
Outside of just the experience of like every job you keep working on, it's like what did you do in your free time or before you got the job you got?
I'm serious. There, very early on, I'm about to be wrapped up. I'm a minute over. I'm done. I'm sorry. I'll answer your question. I'll walk out.
You can absolutely answer the question.
I'm allowed to.
Because there is a half hour break in between, but people are going to start coming in for the next.
Okay, cool. Well, then we'll do that. Answer your question. When I first started out, it really was, I arrived in Los Angeles having a professional portfolio for theater, knowing that I didn't know anything about designing film television. And there it was just what marketable skills I have, and I could build models, do like study models and stuff. And so that's how I see it. I'm going to build models for everybody, and I'm going to sit, keep my head down, and I'm going to look at all of the designers around me and I ask lots of questions. And I would do that at work, and at the end of the day, I would take that drawing, I'd go over to the blueprint machine, because that's what they still were, and I'd take office home and I'd stay out. And I did that for years. And when I wasn't working in between jobs, and that was frequent in the beginning, I would be sitting and designing and copying people's drawings. And I would be, and then what happens is you're looking through and you're seeing things that work, things that don't work, lifting other people's styles, lettering or anything like that, and you're starting to incorporate it. And it was still for many years. I was called a kind of second round of hires on Jurassic Park. Their first round of people were all of the old pros in Hollywood. And by the time I came in, you know, the walls were lined with their work, all the concept stuff. And I swear to God, I'm walking down Hollywood. What am I doing here? Why on earth did these guys hire me? Because it was intimidating. And so I panicked. And I would go to lunch with everybody and I would put their brains in. It was 24 hours job to try to deserve being there. And the truth is you still do that. To continue and work on things, we're still always knowing that there are a lot of people that really want to do what you want to do. You don't ever say no. You don't ever say, I can't do that. You say, we'll figure it out. And then you go and panic if it's something you don't know how to do. And you really figure out and get on the phone. You do this. And come back with something. So that's, I don't know if that answered your question. Yeah, there's a lot of nervous things. Okay, I think that's it for now. Thank you very much, everybody, for listening to the round.